Recorded Books presents Never Forgotten by Alejandra Algorta, translated by Ida Salazar, narrated by Christopher Salazar and Andres Macias Hernandez. And if when I speak I make the same mistakes as others, I'd say, I am from here. You did not befoul me in vain. Fabio Morabito. On the day Fabio forgot, the sun was merciless. His body would no longer do what it had done so many times before, and now his knees do nothing but scrape the ground. His parents told him the body never forgets. One cannot lose what's learned through the flesh, the way in which we walk, dance, run. It is there within the body, the way the fork must enter the mouth so as not to crash into the teeth, and what the body knows, it knows forever. But Fabio forgot how to ride a bicycle, and now he believes his parents have lied to him. And it isn't as if he is a forgetful person. Fabio remembers all the telephone numbers of the houses in which his mother has worked. He remembers the price of every bus fare in the last 3 years. Fabio remembers, also, things he hears and does not understand, like, velocity is equal to distance divided by time, or, more was lost in the deluge and nothing was mine. Yet Fabio forgot how to ride a bicycle. Fabio has never felt any different. He is not the shortest nor the tallest in his class, nor is he the fattest nor the skinniest. In his neighborhood, they haven't given him a nickname, and he has never been without anything important. He appears to be an ordinary boy. His eyes are the color of honey, and his skin is the color of a tree. No, his skin is not tree-colored. It is a yellowish color that wants to be brown, as if someone tree-colored lost their bark. Fabio has also lost that small space in the brain where one keeps memories forever, like the memory of riding a bicycle. It is a tiny rock in the rear of the brain, just above the neck. There, in that tiny rock, the body keeps safe what cannot be forgotten. Sometimes Fabio uses his fingertips to touch the place where the little rock should be, but he only feels the hollow. Perhaps he forgot because he learned on a Wednesday. The children in Bogota normally learn how to ride bicycles on Sundays, but Fabio's father can't teach him to ride a bicycle on that day because on Sundays Fabio's father works. Roberto drives a bus, and he looks so much like Fabio, though he is somewhat plumper, a little bigger, and a bit more serious. You have to be very serious to drive buses in a city like Bogota, especially during times like these, when movement is a business and no one lets anyone work anymore. But those are things Fabio hears his father say and which, in reality, he doesn't understand all that much. What Fabio does understand is that people need to move to live and that Roberto, his father, makes sure they can move about the city without any major problems. The advantage of having a job so important like his is that Fabio's father is one of the few people who knows just how big Bogota is and how much it grows each day, from 30 centimeters to 10 blocks. The disadvantage is that Roberto can only teach his son how to ride a bicycle on a Wednesday, the one day of the week in which what is learned is forgotten. Or perhaps he forgot because the bicycle was the color of salmon. Fabio's mother, whose name is Anna and who has the softest hands in the city, made a deal with the fruit man in the neighborhood and traded 8 bags of her sweet bread rolls for his daughter's used bicycle. The bicycle had always been salmon-colored, with brilliant ribbons falling from the frosted handlebars. Fabio's mother cut the ribbons from the handlebars on that terrible Wednesday when Roberto, her husband, said, "Fabio's not going to school today. I'm going to show him how to ride a bicycle." Or Fabio suddenly forgot because he never learned to ride with training wheels. To both Roberto and Anna, it seems silly to teach Fabio to ride a bicycle with training wheels, only then to teach him how to ride without them. Besides, for Roberto, that his son would learn to ride a bicycle without training wheels made up for the fact that his bicycle was salmon-colored. Fabio doesn't understand the embarrassment his father feels because of the color salmon, and it has nothing to do with how the memory of fish, salmon, snappers, and anchovies, lasts only 10 seconds, the same amount of time it took Fabio to forget. Roberto is embarrassed because for him, the color salmon is the color for little girls, and sky blue is the color for boys. His world is divided between boys and girls and the things which belong to each. Salmon are for girls. Sharks are for boys. Sky for boys, earth for girls, pants for boys, skirts for girls, soup for girls, dry rice for boys. In any case, since the day he learned to ride, the bicycle no longer belonged to the boys and girls of the world. It belonged to Fabio, and it never stopped being the color of salmon.
Get dressed now, Fabio. If you want to ride a girl's bicycle, you will do it like a man, said his father that Wednesday when, against every forecast, Fabio learned to ride a bicycle. Ready?
Ready. With his left hand, Roberto held the handlebars, and with the right, the seat of the bicycle. They hadn't begun to move when Fabio felt the impossibility that the bicycle would hold itself upright without the support of his father.
Pedal now. You won't fall. Pedal calmly and hold yourself with strength.
With his elephant legs, Roberto began to run. It couldn't be so simple. It was a hoax. It was a great cosmic joke. Fabio inhaled and exhaled with quickness. He thought, I trust. And he chose to trust his father. He thought, I can do it. And he did. After all, his father's job is to make it so people move. If his father transports the people of the city from one place to the other with confidence, he can move Fabio from one end of the block to the other.
Dad, please don't let me go.
Fabio's knees melt with fear.
If I don't let you go, you won't learn, his father says.
Don't let me go.
I won't let you go.
You won't let me go?
Even if I let you go, I won't let you go.
Fabio pedals, and each time the bicycle goes faster, and the street becomes less long. The neighbors come out of their houses eager to see Fabio fall. Roberto lets go of the bicycle. Fabio doesn't understand.
Pedal! His father yells.
Pedal, Fabio!
Yell his amused neighbors. The handlebars shake. The front tire moves as if it wants to fly off its metal ties. Fabio pedals and rests all of his weight on the handlebars. It is an iron tube resting on another tube, chained with two wheels. How is it possible that a machine so thin can hold all of his weight and move like this? The street ends. Fabio no longer hears anything and knows he must turn to the left. He stops pedaling and the bicycle continues to glide on the concrete. Fabio tightens his grip on the handlebars and veers slightly to the side. Already another street lies before him, once again, the city. He continues to pedal, and he grows. Fabio grows alongside his bicycle, and he cannot grow any more while at the same time be so light. His neighborhood is small, and he is enormous. The great Fabio, who with his salmon bicycle will manage to fly over the city. Since that day, Fabio no longer was Fabio, skin the color of a tree and ordinary. Now he was Fabio of the bicycle. Fast, Fabio. Fabio, are you leaving? Fabio, you have gone. And just as his father moved people from one place to the other in the city, Fabio now too needed to move to live. And like this, through living, Fabio and his bicycle grew into each other in the way only two parts of the same body can meet. Fabio knew the exact distance between his hand and the brake lever. The bicycle knew when Fabio was going to turn because he pulled his knees inward. The two knew at which speed it was safe for Fabio to let go of the handlebars, The bicycle became a wave that carried Fabio while he raised his arms and felt the wind. She knew that Fabio's weakness was behind his knees, and Fabio knew that the bicycle had two extra screws that protruded from the back tire. But they loved each other just the same. The bicycle was one of a kind. Since the moment Fabio could hold his balance and control the air, travel the city that opened up ahead of him, the bicycle was his. Even though it was salmon-colored, and even though his mother cut the ribbons from the handlebars that Wednesday morning, already beginning to feel so far away. Fabio grew while atop his bicycle. His legs grew such that they became skinny but strong. His eyes also grew, and they now could see more. His hearing became more keen. His hands, now filled with calluses, had the firmness of an oak. Just as his legs, so grew his fears. Fabio knew there were moments when he should pedal with strength to flee from danger, from the dark and empty alleyways. Fabio had never been a cowardly boy, but he always felt it in his body when it was time to run, something which, in a city like Bogota, is right and just. In truth, it is right and just. The neighborhood in which Fabio lived had always been full of dust. His mother would say it was because it was under construction, and because to create something you have to destroy first. The dust was a memory of the things that were there before, and which now waited to be turned into new things. Born of all of its failed plans, Bogota was a monster made of dust, with a hunger for more. Anna also says that Fabio's neighborhood used to be a town on the outskirts of the city, but the monster began to grow and ate the town and others that also became a part of it. The streets folded themselves against the skirts of a hill, and what was once expansive and illuminated turned narrower and darker. Though that was not the monster's fault. Those to blame were the people who had children, who in turn had more children. The blame belonged to people who didn't have enough with one family and needed two or three. The blame was on the construction workers who, to be better construction workers, needed to practice and expand their own homes. They'd call building a flat to lay down an iron, and Fabio imagined all of his neighbors bringing irons and smoothing the ceilings of the house so that it was without a wrinkle, now that it was about to grow. Where there used to run a river, now there was a cracked street, and all of the neighbors brought full pots and pans to see and celebrate the birth of a new apartment. What grows is the home, the neighborhood, and the city. Now nobody asked themselves who is that monster named Bogota, and who is responsible for how much it has grown. In Fabio's neighborhood, they laid down so many irons, the plants hardly found light to grow, which made the dust seem as if there were more of it, and the cold seem colder. Luckily, there is a park where the grass grows freely, because there is nothing to cast a shadow. The park used to be an abandoned field, and when the city began to expand, it became the only space in the neighborhood where greenery grew wild. So they decided to let it be and name it a park. Almost all of Fabio's neighborhood is on a slope. It climbs and falls against the curves of the hill on which it rests. If anyone were to let themselves fall down the hill, they'd reach the cemetery, an enormous lot that now serves as a parking lot for Bogota's buses, which rest there when not moving through the city. Strangely for Fabio, the neighborhood through which he journeyed on his bicycle was much more illuminated than the one he walked, was warmer, more fleeting, softer, more bird than cage. When he was on his bicycle, the dust danced with him. It would lift itself from the ground and soar through the air with violence, only to find he'd gone. Nothing could reach him. Even Bogota's dirtiest and darkest corners swelled into waves that crashed harmlessly as he passed. Fabio knew how to escape, his home always one pedal away in the distance. As soon as Fabio stopped walking, and he stopped walking because his only form of transportation was now his bicycle, other boys and girls like him began to follow. They were attracted by the rumors the neighbors spread about Fabio, half boy and half bicycle, able to pedal while asleep, able to control the tires with his mind. The pack of bicycle children found their leader. They say Fabio doesn't have a house. His bicycle is enough. They say Fabio is made of rubber. No fall can harm or break him. They say Fabio is the son of Hecate, the goddess of the wheel. They say Fabio's feet have never, ever touched the ground. Secretly, Fabio was afraid of the pack of kids who followed him and never stopped to rest. Pablo, Carmen, Alex, Guadalupe, and Fran, who had no worry in the world and who tore through the city streets ready for any danger, they did not fear a thing. Their bicycles could be any animal, one of Genghis Khan's horses, a Bengal tiger, the last dinosaur to have survived extinction. Fabio was the fastest, and though this made the pack follow him, it made it so that with little effort he could leave them behind. In this way, as if by each pedal of his bicycle, the days also accelerated, and 3 entire years passed. 3 years in which, just as the rumors of the neighborhood whispered, Fabio's feet hardly touched the ground. He was certain he could flee. Fabio was invincible, even if there were very few occasions when, in fact, he fled. But just in case, Fabio would go to school on his bicycle, and he returned by bicycle to deliver the bread his mother made to the neighbors. Anna would say she wasn't a baker, but she could be if she wanted. She made bread almost as soft as her hands. Fabio always thought his mother was a baker indeed, even if she denied it. What makes a baker be a baker? He didn't think it possible that Anna would go her whole life making bread without anyone being able to call her a baker, but she didn't like such labels. Before making bread, Anna had spent many years cleaning and cooking in the homes of people who didn't know how to clean or cook. The last house she was in belonged to a very elegant lady whose eyes shed tears when she ate Anna's bread with avocado. Anna did not mind that the lady cried when she ate bread. It bothered her that she'd turn down the volume on the radio and ask Anna not to sing. "Flavor is flavor, ma'am, and in my kitchen, if you can't dance, then you can't make a thing." So they fired her, and Anna began to bake bread for the neighborhood and to clean her own house with the radio volume at full blast, dancing the entire time. Anna's favorite music is bachata, by this man who sings on the radio and whose name is Romeo. Sometimes she says that she fell in love with Roberto, Fabio's father, because when he was a young man, he looked like Romeo. Fabio has heard about the story of Romeo and Juliet at school, and he was glad his mom did not end up with Romeo and that now she's his mother. The story of Romeo and Juliet does not end well. It was during his delivery of bread that Fabio met Alicia, or as the others called her, Mama Alicia. All Fabio knew about the neighbor was that she ate a lot of bread, and she had the name of a villain, a mother villain. Why? Fabio didn't know. She lived alone and didn't seem to have any children. "She took care of all of us as if we were her own children," Anna explained to Fabio one day. "Alicia is better than bread. She's a mother." "If she's such a great mother, then why don't her own kids call her mother?" Fabio replied. "Because she doesn't have children to call her mother, and that's why we do it ourselves." "But you are my mom. I can't have two." "Of course you can. Where did you come up with that idea?" Almost all of the discussions with Anna end with questions that Fabio can't answer. That's how Fabio's parents argue, with questions. At times, a full night will go by filled with their hollering questions and nobody answers anything, until finally they fall asleep, tired of so many doubts. Sometimes, though, Anna is in no mood to ask questions all night, with no prospect of answers when all is said and done, and so she gives in and lets Roberto have his way. There is nothing in the world that makes Roberto sadder, but Anna doesn't know this. To be told one is right is the invisible crown given to lonely people who don't have any friends. And Roberto is, in and of himself, a very lonely man, and it only adds insult to injury if the love of his life silenced him with the invisible crown of having been told he is right. Roberto would much rather live his life asking questions than to be right for one single second. But he has never said this to Anna, and since he's never...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.